In our small chassis series, we have dealt so far with how a shock absorber is constructed and how to set the spring correctly. If you haven't seen those videos yet, I can only recommend you to take a quick look. You can find the links in the video description. After that, continue here. Today, we'll deal with how to set the shock absorber correctly. That means rebound and compression levels. On this shock absorber here, for example, you can see a rebound adjustment up here. A small wheel that can be turned clockwise to close it or counterclockwise to open it. This makes the rebound stage harder or softer. It works similar with this damper, in this case with a little screw. How the whole thing works on the inside, that I want to show you on the flip chart. Here we have the damper cartridge again, here's the piston, and here's the piston rod. Up here is our adjusting wheel, and here's a shaft that leads into the piston below. There are bores in the piston through which the oil can flow from one side to the other. So here is the oil, and it can only move up on this side and down on the other side. Rebound, compression. Here we can draw a small recoil valve. In reality, this looks all a bit different, of course. This is just a provisional drawing for explanatory reasons only. So when the piston goes up, that means rebound, then the oil can only go through this valve. And this rod now affects how much oil can pass. That way I only influence the rebound. But then there are even more complicated things about such a shock absorber. For example, this external fluid reservoir with an adjusting wheel for the pressure stage. What is that for? If a shock absorber has such a reservoir, let's say it goes over here and here is the external fluid reservoir. Then there is also oil inside the external fluid reservoir. The separator, that is usually located in the damper cartridge, is shifted to the external fluid reservoir as well. And below that separator is gas again. Such an external fluid reservoir has multiple advantages. Firstly, it has the advantage that more heat can be derived due to the larger volume, also because it is separated from the shock absorber. As a result, more heat can be absorbed, which means that the working conditions and behaviors remain the same, even under heat. And the external fluid reservoir has a second major advantage. At this point here, where the oil flows from the shock absorber into the external fluid reservoir, I can build similar valves. So it runs freely in one direction and more restricted in the other through another valve.
Durch ein anderes Ventil eher weniger frei, eher langsamer, dass ich halt beeinflussen kann, ob ich es groß mache oder klein. Und dadurch.
That way I can influence whether I make it big or small, and that's how I get my compression state settings. So the opening from the damper towards the external fluid reservoir is adjusted in diameter. That means if I want a low compression state and open it up, then the oil can actually go from the damper to the external fluid reservoir with almost no resistance. If I want a high compression stage, then I make the opening from the damper to the external fluid reservoir quite small. That way, I achieve a hard compression stage. Most of the time the dial sits here, or as a small wheel here or there, or wherever manufacturers like to put it. And with that, you're able to adjust the opening to your needs. Clear so far? Anyone still interested and awake? Let's move on and get to the point where we actually learn how to deal with the settings. Before we set the rebound on the scooter, I would like to show you on our experimental setup how it all works. Usually, the adjustment for the rebound stage is attached to the top of the piston rod. If you turn it clockwise, you turn it shut, and the shock absorber rebounds slowly. If you turn it counterclockwise, you open it up, and the shock absorber rebounds faster. There are clicks here that I think you can hear quite well, and they are very convenient, because A, this will lock my settings, and B, it will serve as orientation. When I count the clicks, I know exactly how much I've adjusted my rebound.
Ich meine Zugstufe gedreht habe. Dann drehe ich die erstmal.
Let's open it all the way and see what happens.
Und dann schauen wir mal, was passiert.
I pull at the construction as hard as I can and then I suddenly let go. Did you see that? The whole construction seesawed. I'll show that again.
Das ganze Gestell.
The whole construction seesaws after the spring has completely rebounded. That would also happen with the scooter, which means there is a lot of disturbance in the chassis. This means that my rebound is set too soft. So, now I'll try the opposite. Now I've set the rebound very hard. Let's see what happens now. Maximum force. And you can see, the frame rebounds much slower. I'll show it again. We see a clear effect, but is that good or bad? The general rule of thumb is that a shock absorber should take about a second to jump back into its original position. But this is a guideline that you can actually forget when it comes to classical scooters, because the spring deflection on classic scooters is far too short. The rule of thumb here is about half a second. I'll set the rebound a little softer now, because it was quite slow. Okay, counterclockwise. And now I'll check again to see if it's fine.
Und jetzt schaue ich noch mal, ob das so richtig ist.
Maximum force, and now I count. 20. 20 of 21 should be about half a second. So the setting seems pretty good to me.
Einstellung kommt mir ziemlich gut vor.
Next, we'll check if the whole thing works on the scooter as well. I do the same thing like before on the experimental setup. I compress the whole thing and then I try to measure the time it takes for the shock absorber to rebound.
Und dann versuche ich die Zeit etwas zu messen, die das Federbein zum Ausfedern benötigt. Nochmal.
Once again. Did you count? I'm at about 20 UA. That is more than half a second. Half a second would be 20. So it feels a little hard to me. I'm going to adjust it again.
Also gehe ich in die Verstellung.
11 clicks harder. Let's see how it looks now. Let's go. Once again. 20. Yeah, that seems pretty good to me now. Around half a second, that should be a relatively optimal setting. Unfortunately, I can hardly show you the effect of the resonance on a Vespa. That is simply because the weight of the Vespa chassis is far too light in proportion, so you hardly ever see that a shock absorber significantly swings if it's adjusted too light. Before we set the pressure level on the scooter, I would like to show you the whole process first with our experimental setup. The compression state adjustment is usually located on the external fluid reservoir, just like here. If I adjust it clockwise, I close the valve. If I turn it counterclockwise, I open the valve. With an open valve, the shock absorber deflects faster. With a closed valve, the shock absorber deflects slower. And that is exactly what I'm adjusting, the compression speed of the shock absorber. The problem with that is that this is level 2 of setting a chassis. Because in comparison to the rebound stage, there are no clear guidelines. But what I can set relatively nicely with that is what is called the hardness of chassis. So exactly that, what we cannot adjust with the spring preload. But as I just said, that is relatively difficult to do and requires a lot of experience and feeling.
Relativ schwer und erfordert einiges an Erfahrung und Gefühl.
Ein Test, a test for this, which gives an approximate reference or guide value, is when you stand in front of the vehicle and try with all your force to compress it as quickly as possible, because the pressure level only works noticeably with fast movements. I'll try to demonstrate that to you. I've set it all the way to the left, that's very soft. And now I'm trying to compress it as quickly as possible. I don't know if you can see it now. I dropped all of my 20 kilos in there and the thing drops relatively quickly.
Das Ding ist relativ schnell in die Knie gegangen. Jetzt mache ich das Gegenteil.
Now I do the opposite. I close it all the way and do the same thing again. Now, that was okay. I think it wasn't that visible, but I felt it. There was more resistance and the shock absorber dropped slower. As a guideline, you can say that if I try that on the vehicle and the shock absorber can be pushed very easily, it is too soft. If it is very difficult to push and I don't get much spring deflection at all when I hit the shock absorber quickly, then it's set too hard. At the very end, you have to determine it in practice. A small trick that could help. I would always set the shock absorber very soft at first, then drive around so that the oil in the shock absorber gets warm. Then I would set the compression stage to very hard and drive around again. Just test the extremes and what is changing in the chassis, then slowly try to approach the right value.
Und dann langsam versuchen, sich den richtigen Wert anzunähern.
In order to test the compression stage on the scooter, I had to change the scooter, because this one now has a shock absorber with compression adjustment installed, which was not the case on the PX. Of course, we have SIP Performance shock absorbers with compression state adjustments available, also for the PX, but it was just not installed on that model yet. It is on this one though, so now I'll try to show you in practice what I've explained in theory before. If you remember what I said about the compression stage, it's not that easy, but as a quick guide you can refer to this. If it bends too easily when you press it quickly, then it's too soft. Let's try that out. That went well. That would almost be okay, but it already felt a bit soft to me. So I'll turn the whole thing a little harder.
Drehe ich das Ganze mal ein bisschen härter.
Turning it clockwise, the valve closes and thus it compresses slower.
Schließt und damit federt es langsamer ein. So. Man sieht, hoffentlich.
Hopefully you can see that it sinks in less now and slower. But for my feeling, it's too slow, so I turn it back a little.
Mein Gefühl ist das zu langsam, also drehe ich es ein Stück zurück.
Clockwise. I did 6 clicks softer. Let's try again.
Jetzt mal gemacht. Noch mal. Ja.
So that seems quite good to me for a dry run. But as I said, get out on the street, try it completely open, try it completely closed, and then slowly feel how the compression stage works.
Am besten die Druckstufe funktioniert. Gut. Damit haben wir eigentlich fast
well,
alle Funktionen
with that we have talked about almost all functions. One more thing remains, the double compression stage. And that I'll explain to you over there. This is a shock absorber that has a double compression stage adjustment. Here are 2 settings, red and gold. And if you need a lot of experience in feeling to set a simple compression stage, here it gets even more complicated. The double compression stage has high speed and low speed settings. That means on one hand how much the shock absorber compresses when the force is applied slowly and on the other hand when the force is applied quickly. Low speed are longer curves on the road. High speed are small potholes, for example. How do I adjust that? In principle, you have to try to look at the effects only, and you really need a lot of experience. I can only give you so much as a guideline. On the highway, it is better to be softer, and for the low speed level to have a little more comfort.
Um halt etwas mehr Komfort zu haben.
If you're on the racetrack, just set the high speed level a little harder. That brings grip and stability.
Das bringt Grip und Stabilität.
But that's something that shouldn't be too stiff on the highway, because otherwise you'll feel your back every time you drive through some pothole.
Sonst knallt euch das jedes Mal ins Kreuz, wenn ihr durch irgendein Schlagloch fahrt.
I honestly have to admit, I do have a lot of experience, even on the racetrack, but to set high and low speed compression stages is a big task for me too.
Ist auch für mich eine große Aufgabe.
For most purposes, it's enough if there is a simple compression state adjustment. Actually, I disabled this for everything that is not taking place on the racetrack. That is exactly the reason why our SIP performance shock absorbers are only available with a simple compression state adjustment. I can recommend that to you. They have a good price-performance ratio, with compression state, rebound stage, and spring preload settings, as well as a progressive spring. They actually have everything that you need. And that is exactly the reason why we built them and offer them that way. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video. As you can see, all the adjustment options on the shock absorbers are not that easy. There's also no guidance book available to adjust the chassis correctly.
Ein Buch mit sieben Siegeln oder unschaffbar ein Fahrwerk richtig einzustellen.
The basic setting can be done relatively easy though, with a little accuracy and a little thinking. Very important. Hard doesn't always mean sporty. You should always remember that. Because the important thing is that the tire is always pressed evenly on the road. And if you have a chassis that's set too hard, you usually have poor road contact. Please, don't overdo it. But otherwise, have fun adjusting.
Lass davon bitte die Finger. Und ansonsten viel Spaß beim Einstellen. Ich hoffe, es
hat I hope you liked it. Please subscribe to the channel and press the bell, so that you will stay up to date. Until next time. Bye. Oh, one more thing. Did this video help you with adjusting your chassis? If so, please let me know in the comments and share the video with a friend that could need help too.